Hey everyone, it's Anson again, and first off, I want to say a huge thank you to all of you who responded to my last video on installing unsupported Sequoia. Your personal experiences and messages of gratitude have been much appreciated. Today, I'm going to clarify some questions about the install process, I'm going to share some of the experiences that you all shared with me, and I'm going to answer the question on whether or not the upgrade was worth it. Let's get into it. Doing this upgrade on machines that only have 4 gigs of RAM will probably result in poor performance. It's best to have at least 8 gigs of RAM for upgrading to unsupported Sequoia. A few people have asked about the size of the flash drive needed for this installation. I mentioned using a 16 gigabyte flash drive or larger. I actually used a 64 gigabyte flash drive. And if you really want to avoid absolutely any hiccups or errors during the installation process, you should probably use a 32 gigabyte flash drive or larger, and I apologize for the confusion about that. On a similar note, make sure that you have enough actual hard drive space to perform this upgrade. You only need about 16 gigs of space to download the Sequoia installer, but you'll need about 25 gigs of space to actually install it, and it's probably best to have at least 30 to 40 gigs of free space. This is just another reason why it's a really good idea to just wipe that hard drive clean while you do the install, because then you know you'll have enough space to install it. Some users have mentioned that the boot menu moves quickly, sometimes auto-selecting a boot drive before you can choose the EFI volume and then the install Sequoia option. To fix this, just make sure that you select the boot options quickly when the boot menu appears. If you make a mistake and don't do it quick enough, just restart the computer holding option to get back to the boot menu and give it another shot. Also, remember that some features don't currently work on unsupported Macs. For example, Apple Intelligence only runs on Macs with Apple Silicon chips, and iPhone screen mirroring requires an Intel Mac with a T2 security chip or an Apple Silicon Mac. It's possible that Dortania will get these features working on unsupported Macs in the future, especially the iPhone mirroring feature. This requires attestation from the T2 security chip, and Dortania has been open about their challenges in cracking the T2 security chip. That's the same reason why you can't run this unsupported Sequoia upgrade on 2018 MacBook Airs yet. But I wouldn't hold your breath for too long regarding Apple Intelligence. It seems that this feature will really only work well on Macs with Apple Silicon chips. I also want to mention that if you've completed this installation and you're still seeing a white desktop background or it feels really sluggish, try running post-install root patches from OpenCore again. For some Mac models like the 2013 MacBook Airs, OpenCore needs access to the kernel debug kit, or KDK, and in some cases access to metal libraries. After you run post-install patches the first time, it should get your Wi-Fi driver working, which will allow you to connect to the internet so OpenCore can automatically download and install the necessary libraries the next time post-install patches are run. If you can't get on the internet, use another computer, download the KDK and the Metal Graphics libraries, put them on a flash drive, move them over to your computer that you're upgrading, double-click to install both of them, and then run post-install root patches again in OpenCore. A link to all of these libraries is in the description, and this should get it working for those of you whose drivers don't seem to be fully installing. In regards to user comments, I've heard from many of you regarding your experiences with the installation process and how Sequoia is running on your machines, which greatly helps the community as a whole. Here's what a few people had to say. Broken Famous had a smooth installation on a 2012 MacBook Pro, saying it runs smoother than a 12-year-old Catalina installation. Multiple users commented saying the install went smoothly on 2015 MacBook Pros. Vincent Polisi upgraded a number of machines using my video, including 2 2010 Mac Pros, a Mac Mini, and some iMacs. CAD and Steckwork installed Sequoia on 2016 MacBook Pros, but had some issues with messages, maps, and FaceTime. I'm wondering if maybe running post-install patches again might help there. If anyone has resolved a similar experience, I'd love to hear about it in the comments section, and I'm sure that they would as well. Peter installed it on a 2013 MacBook Pro like me, and had a similar experience where it seemed to run smoother than on Sonoma. So, the million-dollar question, is upgrading to macOS 15 Sequoia on an unsupported Mac worth it? In my personal experience, absolutely. Sequoia runs more smoothly on my 2013 MacBook Pro than Sonoma did. The system seems more responsive, apps load faster, my fans don't run nearly as much, and the overall performance of the system has improved, noticeably. However, it's essential to weigh the pros and cons. Here are some of the pros. Improved performance, faster boot times, and smoother multitasking. access to new features. Even without Apple Intelligence and iPhone screen mirroring, there are plenty of new tools to enhance your productivity, especially in Notes and Safari. And extended hardware life, breathing new life into old Macs, is both eco and cost-friendly. Some of the cons to consider are missing features. As mentioned, some features are unavailable on unsupported hardware. Potential bugs. While OCLP does an excellent job, you might encounter occasional glitches depending on your Mac model. It really helps to read through the OpenCore documentation before performing the install to help avoid any surprises. And remember, Apple won't provide official support for setups that are unsupported. If you can live without the missing features and don't mind a bit of a DIY approach, I would say the upgrade is absolutely worth it. But check to make sure that your Mac is supported first. Stay tuned to this playlist right here for updates when incremental macOS upgrades come out and for more tips on unsupported macOS installations. And if you've just been lurking and haven't taken the leap yet into unsupported Sequoia, this video right down here at the bottom will take you to the promised land. That's all I've got for today. I'm Anson Alexander, and I'll see you in the next one.